Look at all the evil that has been committed by those worshipping a pantheon of false gods, and those whom have co-opted religions that may have at one time been devoted to the one true God. What kind of evil do you suppose a truly godless society operating under a New World Order would commit? To get an idea, simply look around at the world today, at the evil that is being committed to bring this new order of the age into being. In addition, one can look to the evil that has been committed by what are essentially anti-Christian theocratic states like Nazi Germany, Soviet Russia, and Communist China to get a true sense of what the Luciferians have in store for this new world and this new technological age they've been working tirelessly to create. Now, all this feeds back into the video I did concerning Saul Paul and Bar-Jesus Elymas, which was simply a rendition of Acts 13, chapters 1 through 12. In it, an apostle of Christ and founding member of the early church was asked to counsel with a government official, Sergius Paulus, whom was interested in the new religion that was taking the world by storm at that time, winning people's hearts and minds. No doubt Sergius heard something about this new religion, and being an intelligent man, wanted to know more about this phenomenon, so he apparently sent for these disciples whom were visiting Cyprus, where he had a seat of power. In his council was a person going by the name Bar-Jesus, whom was described as a false prophet. 2 Corinthians 11 discusses the fact that some of the early church members were not as they seemed. Here, Paul talks about a corruptive influence that was creeping its way into the church, as he wrote, "But what I do, that I will do, that I may cut off occasion from them which desire occasion, that wherein they glory, they may be found as we. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works." End quote. Clearly, he is speaking of false apostles who are working to pervert and deceive those whom were interested in the truth about the gospel of Christ by transforming themselves into likenesses of the true apostles and pretending to be ministers of righteousness when they were really ministers of evil and darkness. These workers of deceit would seek to confuse and confound those interested in the Lord's message, just as the counterfeit prophets of the Old Testament had done, and whom were the source of serious problems and strife for the true prophets of that age, even acting against the Savior Jesus Christ himself when he came in the flesh to help atone for the sins of mankind. Therefore, the followers of Satan put on the garb and learned to speak a similar language to that of the prophets and ministers of God, so that they can worm their way into key positions within a religion and pervert it, setting it up for ultimate destruction by subverting and co-opting it with evil influences that have been carefully placed within. Interestingly, anyone whom has operated in the conspiracy theory community ought to be well aware of this phenomenon, as this type of maneuvering, propagation of lies, and attempts to muddy the waters and distort and hide the truth is very active today in that regard. Obviously, this is a key feature and part of the Antichrist plan, and Saul, who was also known as Paul, met one of these men when he went to preach the word of God to Sergius Paulus in Paphos. It is interesting that the two names of Saul and Paul are used in Acts 13 to perhaps denote the idea that Saul had undergone a transformation from someone whom was previously a persecutor of Christ into one of his apostles and early purveyors of the early church when he confronts someone going by the name of Bar-Jesus, which could be taken to mean that this man was presenting himself as a person of Judeo-Christian faith, and despite his outward appearance and professed beliefs, actually sought to interfere with the early apostles whom were ministering to Sergius Paulus. It is clear that the early church was dependent upon winning over the hearts and minds of the leadership of nations in order to spread as it did, so it would be no accident that the enemies of the faith would try to put themselves in close proximity to the leaders of that day in order to change their view and give them a watered-down and corrupted version of the phenomenon that was taking hold at that time, while they actively sought to stamp it out. It is also interesting that Saul was able to wield the same power that was levied against him by Christ, whom had blinded him in order to convert and acquire his remarkable zealotry and apply it toward spreading the gospel of Christ. When Saul blinded someone whom had been pretending to be a man of Christ, going by the name of Bar-Jesus. Acts 9, chapters 1 through 5, King James Version reads, "And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest, and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogue, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round him a light from heaven, and he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, Who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks." End quote. This encounter left him temporarily blinded until another early apostle, Ananias, was instructed to go to him. When the two met through the power of Christ, his sight was returned, and he was filled with the Holy Ghost and was converted, becoming a devout follower of Christ's teachings and someone whom was very instrumental in the rise of Christianity. Therefore, because of his history of being blinded and healed through the power of Christ, it is remarkable that the power to temporarily blind another was given unto him so that he may help make a wider point, which has lasted through the ages, concerning those whom seek to confound and confuse people while pretending to be men of God, full of wisdom. Bar-Jesus might be taken to mean son of Jesus or son of Joshua or son of Yah who saves, which seems to indicate that he was pretending to be something that he wasn't, since Saul calls him the exact opposite of what his name represents, a quote, child of the devil, unquote, and a quote, enemy of all righteousness, unquote, during his encounter with this being. What we see is Saul being referenced as Saul until the transformative moment where he wields this power. At such time, he seems to take on his new name, Paul. We see a persecutor of Christians and a man of Jewish descent turn into a devout Christian with the strength and power of God, acting through the Holy Ghost, who would become the apostle to the Gentiles. At the same time, we see the exposure of someone claiming to be a man of Christ, unmasked as a fraud, sorcerer, false prophet, and a practitioner of the occult. As a previously notorious man of evil comes into being and takes on his true form as a force of good through a process of redemption, the true form of a pretender and teacher of false doctrine is shown for what it is. A person pretending to be good is exposed as evil, as a person thought to be evil demonstrates he is a force of good. As this occurred, the false and presumptive name Bar-Jesus goes from being something that is meant to inspire feelings associated with the goodness and the gospel, and hence make people more likely to let down their guard, to something that is cloaked in darkness and mystery, and something which even to this day people are trying to unravel and make some sense out of, Elymas. Thus, this defining moment marks the completion of his transformation and conversion to Christianity. As having the ability to demonstrate the power of God through his own act seems to mark a finality in this process, and he takes on his new name. However, it is equally important to note that this transformation comes at the expense of a purveyor of evil, that as Paul was strengthened through Christ, a weakening of evil occurred in the man that he faced, and that man also had two names. I think that it is another demonstration that the magic and true light of God is far superior to the black magic and false light which the legions of Satan's followers attempt to use to work against God. This is a triumph of light over darkness, of good over evil. However, I think that the passage in Acts 13, 1 through 12 goes even deeper than that and demonstrates something about the larger nature of this phenomenon which the governor was seeking to understand by calling upon the prophets, the rise and spread of Christianity, and what it meant for the world and the relation between those seeking righteousness and those responsible for corruption and injustice. One thing that Christianity represents is the spreading of the word of God and the promises made by God to the Jews, also to the Gentiles. And as such, the war is on for the mind of this extremely large demographic, the world's people. The world and its people are the stakes, as well as which will reign supreme, lies in corruption, or truth and righteousness. As Christ's sacrifice pushed the awareness of these doctrines unto the masses, the strength of goodness in the world increased and spread, as did the Word of God, while the dark forces which were previously operating more openly had to work to hide themselves even better than what they had done before in the past. or risk exposure and ultimate defeat. Therefore, just as the name change from Saul to Paul is significant, so too is the reason that Bar-Jesus was also a double-named figure in this passage. The story of Saul's transformation and encounter with his vile being shows a dark force turning towards light on the one hand, while on the other hand, the false light used by the spirits of darkness is pushed further back into the shadows, retreating and having to regroup and reform, to revise a new strategy and hide itself once more after being exposed for what it was, and its preaching of a counterfeit doctrine. Thus, this Antichrist and pretender is being called out for what and whom he is by Saul, as Saul completes his transformation to Paul. Bar-Jesus is then exposed as something that is more akin to a son of Zeus than a son of Jesus, more of a Jewish student of Zoroastrian mysteries than a disciple of the Judeo-Christian ethos. We see two different characters take on their true spirits in this interplay and exchange of magic. Finally, I think that this is a foreshadowing of things that were yet to come for the church and the restructuring of the relationship between light and darkness at that point in time with the onset of Christianity. This story should have served as a warning to the church about the practitioners of these mystery schools trying to worm their way in and corrupt church doctrine, and provide some indication about what the Antichrist is going to look like in the latter days, and what this spirit has been busy trying to accomplish for the past 2,000 years with many successes which have helped to unfairly brand Christianity as a danger to world peace and a force of evil in the world. This branding of Christianity as a danger and violent religion and as part of the reason for most of the world's problems is something that is necessary to convince people of in order to officially establish a false doctrine with a false prophet under the final manifestation of the Antichrist spirit in the flesh. This is something that is in the interest of their evil. For when the relationship between light and darkness is again shifted, and evil exhibits its last hurrah and final push for victory, which is doomed for failure, despite what today's magicians and practitioners of this ancient form of deception and manipulation delude themselves into thinking, it will make more people willing to accept the falsehood it depends upon as the truth. The false apostles, deceitful workers, and Satan himself, written about by Paul in 2 Corinthians, have been hard at work since Saul's transformation into Paul. This spirit has been able to learn, adapt, and change its methods while carrying on the tradition of Bar-Jesus, which is to twist the gospel, confound man, and prevent God's message from being taken up by those whom would wish to hear it. The purpose has been to erode the foundation that was built when Jesus died on the cross, and also with all of the early martyrs like Paul himself, whom helped win over the hearts and minds of the people with their immense faith in the power of the Holy Spirit, but who were murdered for their beliefs. This erosion has left many churches a former shell of what they are supposed to be, and primed to be either eliminated or incorporated into the larger New World religion, as they have effectively watered down the message of Christianity, and, like many of the false teachers before them, focused solely on those fluffy messages people wanted to hear, instead of the truth, which zealots like Paul were so adamant about demonstrating through their acts, especially those which exposed evil for what it is. If this succeeds, then the types of horrors which were seen under communism and fascism in the 20th century is only a mere sample of what the men who devised those systems have in store for the wider global version of their governance, which smaller national experiments in totalitarianism were designed to allow them to perfect for such evil and global purposes. In conclusion, the onset of Christianity marked the beginning of a shift from darkness toward light in the world, while the forces that serve a dark master have had to camouflage and hide themselves, as they have been doing work to subvert the truth and corrupt the gospel, until such time as they are ready to remove their masks and emerge from the shadows completely, seeking to reign in an age of darkness in a manner that is opposite what we saw with the rise of the Christian faith, setting back the strides that Christianity has made in making the world a better place through its teachings. There are people who feel like now is the time for them to make their move, but as Acts 13 reminds us, the dark magic that is to be relied upon is inferior to the work of God, and it will ultimately leave these people exposed for what they are when they attempted, making it easier for evil to be vanquished from the earth once and for all. Although the showdown between Saul, Paul, and Bar-Jesus, Elymas, was an individual battle, it foreshadows what will happen during the final showdown between good and evil on a collective level. Because of this, I think that it is something that is important to consider. Thanks for listening.
And tyrants live in dread of men with followings.
But Judas, the Master is no threat to Herod.
Any leader on the side of truth is a threat to tyranny. A danger to Tiberius, the puppets of Rome, Herod, his brothers, to Caiaphas.
The Master doesn't preach revolt. He talks of love and forgiveness.
Israel will never be free to love and forgive until her people unite against Rome. Rise to a leader who will guide them, order them, command them to obey.
Another tyrant?
No, a king. Their own king, a king of Israel. One they will accept as a David, a Moses, a Hezekiah.
This is an old, old dream. For 3 centuries, people have talked of it, but accomplished nothing.
But it will come. Not in a year or 2 or 3, perhaps, but when enough men are willing to die for a kingdom of their own.
I was a zealot. Pledged to restore Israel to its place among the nations of the world. For years, like all the Brotherhood, I preached hate and fight and destroy. But now I have heard the Master speak of love and forgiveness, and I want more than revenge or temporal power or the glories of this world.
So do the rest of us, and the hundreds that have heard him, and the thousands that will.